Hi everyone, today we'll be going through a new chapter. In fact, it is the last chapter of Introduction to Economics. So today's video, we're going to be talking about some of the basic stuff you have to understand for the open economy. So what is an open economy? An economy is known to be open when there is economic activity between a domestic community and an outside community. Before this, we were only talking about one single country. Now, we're going to bring in more countries into the picture. And what's happening between these countries is that there are people or businesses that are trading goods and services. So the trading of goods and services is known as economic activities. So why will there be these kind of economic activities between two countries? Remember chapter 1? We weren't only talking about the PPF, but we were also talking about specializing and trading. And one of the reasons why two countries would want to specialize and trade is so that they can help each of them push out the PPF, which is also the consumption possibility frontier, right? So both economies become better off because they can produce more, hence they can consume more. So this economic activity in general will be between two parties. So we have the domestic country, which is the home country, and we have the foreign country, or what you can call the other country, right? So the people that live in a domestic country are known as residents or locals. I think you should already know this by now. And the people from the other countries are known as non-residents or foreigners. In Singapore, we love to call them foreign talent. So I'm introducing you these terms because I'll be using them quite frequently in the explanations later. So when people trade goods and services, you're going to have exports and imports, right? So let's go through one by one. What are exports? Well, basically, exports are the shipping of goods and services out of the country. And more specifically here, we are talking about the domestic country. Okay, so these are goods and services that are produced domestically, produced by the home country. And all these goods and services are going to be sold to foreigners. And exports also includes tourism into the domestic country. Why? Because you've got foreigners coming to your home country who are non-residents and they are buying your stuff. Okay, so knowing this, another way to explain exports is that these are actually inflows of value to the domestic country. Well, why is it an inflow since we are selling stuff? Well, I'm talking about inflow of value. And that is because any foreign expenditure on domestic goods and services is actually domestic income. It is income to the home country. They are the ones that created the goods and services, right? And that is why aggregate expenditure and the GDP is going to have a positive relationship with exports. When exports increase, your AE and your income is going to increase. So understanding this, let's move on to imports. What are imports? So imports refer to the purchasing of goods and services from outside of the domestic country. Okay, so these are goods and services that are produced foreignly and are purchased by residents or locals, people of the home country. Imports also refer to domestic tourism to foreign countries. Whenever a resident or a local person goes overseas to buy certain goods and services, that is considered as an import. And imports are actually outflows of economic value from the domestic country to a foreign country. And the reason for this is because any domestic expenditure on foreign goods and services is actually income to the foreign country, right? It is the foreigners that created these goods and services. Therefore, if anybody were to buy them, it is income to the foreign country. It is not domestic income. And that is why there is actually a negative relationship between imports and your aggregate expenditure and GDP. So knowing these two pieces of information, what can we say about the aggregate expenditure equation? Well, the AE equation is simply going to sum up to this. You've got AE equals to Y equals to C plus I plus G plus X minus M. So what we can do with plus X and minus M is that we can sum it into NX, which stands for net exports. Okay, so your net exports is simply X minus M. Okay, your net exports is the net of the exports. Okay, it's as simple as that. Okay, very good. So let me give you a question that you can ponder about before we move on to the next branch in this mind map. And the question is, how do you think countries account for all the monetary transactions between themselves and the rest of the world? Well, the answer is that they do this using what we call a balance of payments, which is made up of your current account, which we denote as CA, your capital account, which we denote as KA, and lastly, your change in reserves, which we denote as the change in R. So your current account is actually made up of three major components. The first component is your net exports, which is your exports minus your imports. So your net exports is actually a function of the domestic income as well as epsilon. Now epsilon here refers to the real interest rate, which is something that we'll be talking about later in this video. Now the second thing that makes up the current account is actually your net investment income. So just remember this, whenever we say net, it is always a net between an outflow and an inflow. Okay, so in the case of a net investment income, it is basically taking the investment income from a domestic investment in some kind of a foreign asset, and you minus the payments to foreigners for their investment in some kind of domestic asset. Okay, so it's your income minus your payment. It's an inflow minus an outflow. That's why you have a net. So investment income here actually refers to the interest return that you can actually make from an asset. Okay, so what's important over here, okay, is that this does not refer to any of the cash that is used to actually go and invest or the cash that you get from selling any of your foreign assets. So I'm talking about the amount of money that you need to use to buy that asset, right? So this amount of money is actually known as the capital investment. So capital investment is not the same as interest return. So your capital investment is actually the principal, right? And this will be accounted for in the capital account, which we'll be talking about later. And that is why it's called a capital investment. So the third component refers to net cash transfers. Again, you have another net, so it's the net of an inflow and an outflow. So what are we trying to net over here? So basically, what you can do is to take the cash transfers from a foreign country into a domestic country, and you minus the cash transfers from this domestic country to another foreign country. So cash transfers here can refer to a lot of things. Okay, one of it could be maybe some kind of a disaster relief funding or expenditure to help another country. So maybe if, let's say, another country has a flood or has some kind of a disaster, maybe a tornado or something like that, what we can do is we can actually send some kind of a medical aid or military aid, and that is known as cash transfers because it's an expenditure that is flowing to another country. Okay, so let's move on to the capital account, which refers to a net change in the ownership of national assets between locals and foreigners. Remember, I was talking about capital investment. So the capital account basically accounts for all the investment money coming in and all the investment money that's going out of a domestic country. So the amount of capital actually depends on the level of domestic interest rates and foreign level of interest rates. So I over here is the domestic interest rates, and I star refers to the foreign interest rates. So what you would notice is that there is going to be a positive relationship between the domestic interest rates and the capital account. Why? Because when interest rates rise, this means that there is going to be a higher return on investment on domestic assets. Therefore, capital will flow into the domestic country from the foreign countries. And there's going to be a negative relationship between the foreign interest rates and the domestic capital account. And that's because when the foreign interest rates rise, there's going to be a higher investment return on these foreign assets. Therefore, capital is going to flow out of the domestic country into the foreign country. So when domestic capital flows out of the country, the domestic capital account is going to go down. So having this concept in mind, you can actually summarize the capital account to be the change in foreign ownership of domestic assets minus the change in domestic ownership of foreign assets. So when there are more foreigners owning your domestic assets than domestic people owning foreign assets, what happens is that your capital account is more than zero. And when there is lesser foreign ownership of domestic assets than domestic ownership of foreign assets, then your capital account is less than zero. So in this case, capital is flowing into the country. And in this case, capital is flowing out of the country. Okay, so that's more about it for the capital account. The last thing you have to understand is capital mobility. So capital mobility here refers to the ability of funds to be moved across national borders in pursuit of high returns. And of course, the returns is going to come from either your domestic interest rates or your foreign interest rates, as discussed earlier. So for introduction to economics, there's going to be two extreme ends that capital mobility can adopt. The first one would be zero capital mobility, and the second one would be perfect capital mobility. So by using some rational deductive logic, I think you will understand that when there's zero capital mobility, it means that no funds can move across borders, okay, for any investment purpose. And when this is the case, your balance of payment, which is made up of your current account and your capital account, is only going to be made up of the current account, because the capital account is going to be equal to zero since no funds can come in or out, so you're stuck at zero. So for perfect capital mobility, basically it means that funds can flow very, very freely across borders for investment purposes. And if that's the case, you're going to have your balance of payment, which is made up of your current and your capital account, and your capital account is going to be super significant when we talk about changes within the capital account and its effects on the balance of payment. So we'll be going through this in the last video for chapter 14, so just hang in there. Moving on to the changes in reserves for the last component of the balance of payment, we are actually referring to foreign currency in the form of reserves for the central bank. And this change is actually just a balancing item for the balance of payment. And it is meant to keep the balance of payment, which is made up of the capital, the current and the capital account, to be equal to zero. So when the balance of payment is equal to zero, we have actually reached the long run equilibrium. So if there is zero capital mobility, your balance of payment is only your current account, and when that is equal to zero, which means exports equals to imports, then you have reached a long run equilibrium. Okay, awesome. So it's time for the last branch of this mind map, and we're going to be talking about exchange rates. There are two types of exchange rates you have to take note of. And the first type is known as your nominal exchange rate. I got this feeling that you already know what the second type is, but let's cover the nominal exchange rate first, shall we? So talking about the nominal exchange rate, there's actually two types of quotes for this exchange rate, okay? So the term quote here actually refers to how we express the nominal exchange rate, okay? So the two types of quotes are the direct quote as well as the indirect quote. So we're only going to be using one of these quotes for introduction to economics, okay? But it's good for you to know both. So the direct quote here actually refers to the number of domestic currency per one unit of foreign currency. How much domestic currency do you need to exchange for one piece of foreign currency? So that's what the direct quote is trying to say. To make things easier, let's use real life example, shall we? So let's say our domestic country is the USA, which uses the dollar, and the foreign country would be the United Kingdom, which uses the pound. So to use the direct quote to express the exchange rate between the dollar and the pound, what we're going to do is we're going to take the dollar and we're going to divide it by the pound. So this is the direct quote. This is the number of domestic currency per one unit of foreign currency. That's why we take the domestic currency, which is the dollar, and we divide it by the pound. So from the time of recording, this exchange rate is 1.639 US dollar for one British pound. So you need to give the money changer 1.639 US dollars before you can get one British pound. So you're actually buying foreign currency. Therefore, the direct quote is actually the price of foreign currency in terms of domestic currency. Now let's move on to the indirect quote. The indirect quote is the amount of foreign currency per one unit of domestic currency. After you have understand the direct quote, it is very simple to find the indirect quote. What you do is you just flip this figure around. So instead of dollar divided by pound, you've got pound divided by dollar. And to find the nominal exchange rate, what you're going to do is to again flip the direct quote into the indirect quote. So I'm going to take £1 divided by $1.639. And that gives me the indirect quote of 0.61 pounds per one US dollar. So the indirect quote is actually the price of the domestic currency in terms of a foreign currency. So if I go to the money changer, I will have to give this money changer 0.61 pounds for one US dollar. For the introduction to economic syllabus, what we'll be using is the direct quote, okay? So now that you've understand both types of quotes, just remember that you have to use the direct quote for your exams and when you write your answers, okay? So let me introduce to you a way to remember that you're using the direct quote and what the direct quote means. So just remember that we are directly quoting the price of the foreign currency, okay? And that is why I say one foreign currency costs X amount of domestic currency. Okay, so that is how I would remember that. I'm using the direct quote, and this is what the direct quote means. Okay, Now let's move on to the real exchange rate. Why do we need the real exchange rate, which is represented by epsilon? Well, that's because people care about their purchasing power. So it's just like real income, right? So people want to know how many units of domestic goods and services do they have to give up for one unit of foreign goods and service. So that is what purchasing power really means. So the generic price level for domestic goods and services are denoted with P, which is in US dollar. The generic price level for foreign goods and services will be denoted as P star, which is in pounds. So how are we going to convert this pounds into US dollar? We need to convert this pounds into US dollar so that we can do a proper comparison between the number of domestic goods we have to give up for your foreign goods and services. So we are using the direct quote, which means to quote the exchange rate, we are going to take the domestic currency divided by the foreign currency. If I were to multiply this by the foreign currency, what I'm going to get is the domestic currency. Therefore, if I take the nominal exchange rate, which is denoted by capital E, and I multiply it by the foreign generic price level, what I'm going to get is the price of foreign goods and services in terms of domestic currency. So now that I've got that, what I can do is I can take the entire price of foreign goods and services in terms of domestic currency and divide it by my domestic price level. And that is going to give me my real exchange rate, which is the amount of domestic goods and services that I have to give up for one unit of foreign goods and services. Okay, so it's that easy. If you're going to use the indirect quote, then the P star is going to be on the denominator rather than the numerator. Okay? But you're using the direct quote, so just remember that the star is always up in the sky. Okay, for the last sub-branch of this mind map, we're going to be talking about exchange rate policies. There are two types of exchange rate policies that you're going to know for introduction to economics. The first one would be a flexible exchange rate policy. This is also known as a floating exchange rate policy, but just know that it is flexible at this point of time. So when the central bank adopts a flexible exchange rate policy, what happens is that they're actually allowing the nominal exchange rate to fluctuate according to any change in balance of payment, because the change in balance of payment is actually going to cause your nominal exchange rate to either go up or go down. Okay, in proper terms, you know, your currencies are either going to appreciate or depreciate. So we're going to talk about that more in the next few videos. So let me quickly bring you through the foreign exchange market, or for short, we call it the Forex market. So on the vertical axis, you're going to have your price of foreign currency, which is actually your nominal exchange rate in the direct quote. On the horizontal axis, you're going to have your quantity of foreign currency. So here's your demand for foreign currency, and here's your supply for foreign currency. So this is the domestic Forex market, okay? So equilibrium at point A gives you a nominal exchange rate of E naught. Let's take a look at what affects the supply of foreign currency. So, supply of foreign currency would increase when exports increase. The rationale for this is actually quite simple. When you're exporting, you're selling domestic goods and services, right? So, domestic goods and services are priced in what currency? Well, it's obviously priced in the domestic currency. So, for these foreigners to buy the domestic goods and services, they will need to go to the Forex market, change their foreign currency for our domestic currency before they can buy our stuff. And that is why the supply of foreign currency will increase when there is more exports, because there are more foreigners putting foreign currency into the Forex market to get their domestic currency. Just remember that domestic goods and services are priced in domestic prices, okay, which is also domestic currency. Alright, so the supply of foreign currency is also going to increase when there is more foreign investment in domestic assets. And again, the rationale for this is also very simple. In what currency do you think domestic assets are being priced at? Well, obviously, it is priced in the domestic currency. So when a foreigner wants to invest in a domestic asset, what he needs to do is he needs to go to the Forex market, our Forex market, give them his foreign currency, and that is where the supply of foreign currency increases, and then he gets in return domestic currency, and he can finally invest in that domestic asset. So that is why the supply of foreign currency is going to increase when there is more foreign investment in domestic assets. So now let's take a look at what affects the demand for foreign currency. The demand for foreign currency is going to increase when the amount of imports increase. So the rationale for this is, again, very simple. When domestic people are buying more stuff from overseas, what they need to do is they need to go to the Forex market and exchange their domestic currency for foreign currency before they can buy their foreign goods and services. Because why? the foreign goods and services are in terms of foreign currency. So you need foreign currency to buy those stuff, right? So that is why the demand for foreign currency will increase when we are importing more. And also the demand for foreign currency is going to increase when there is more domestic investment in foreign assets. Okay, so the rationale for this is, again, very, very easy. When domestic people want to invest in foreign assets, these foreign assets are priced in terms of foreign currency. So therefore, we need to go to the forex market and ask for foreign currency. Okay, so that is where the demand for foreign currency increases, and we exchange it in return for our domestic currency, and that's where we can actually invest in these foreign assets. Okay, cool. Let's assume that one of this stuff happens to the demand curve, and the demand curve shifts to the right, which brings us to an equilibrium of point B, and we have a new nominal exchange rate of E1. So you see, the price of foreign currency has increased. Therefore, what we say is that the foreign currency has appreciated, or we say that the domestic currency has depreciated. Now, the domestic currency is known to be depreciating because we now have to pay more domestic currency for that same amount of foreign currency. So you see, the strength, the power of the domestic currency has fallen because we're going to need more of it to buy that foreign currency. That is why we say the domestic currency has depreciated. Okay, now let's assume that the supply curve is going to shift to the right. Okay, and this gives us an equilibrium point of point C and a new nominal exchange rate of E1. So you see, E has fallen. So now the price of foreign currency is lower, therefore the foreign currency has depreciated. However, the domestic currency has appreciated because we now need lesser domestic currency to buy that foreign currency. The price of the foreign currency has fallen. Therefore, we need lesser domestic currency. Lesser domestic currency basically means that the domestic currency is now more powerful, it's stronger, it can get us more foreign currency. And that is why we say that the domestic currency has appreciated. And you also notice that when the supply curve shifts to the right, what happens is that there is a positive balance of payment. Why? Because your balance of payment is made up of your net exports, which is X minus M, plus your capital account. So exports increase, which means that your net exports is more than zero, giving you a positive current account. Or if, let's say, there is more foreign investment, which means capital is flowing in, therefore your capital account is more than zero. So that is how I ended up with a positive balance of payment. And for the case where the demand curve shifts out, I actually have a negative balance of payment. So let's take a look at the BOP again. So when imports increase, basically my net exports is going to be negative, giving me a negative current account. Or if there is more domestic investment in foreign assets, which means that capital is flowing out, then my capital account will be in a negative. And that is how I got a negative balance of payment. Well, if you don't understand all these points right here, don't worry. We'll be covering them in detail in the next few videos. So just hang in there. Okay, so that was the flexible exchange rate policy where the nominal exchange rate was able to fluctuate. Let's look at the case where it is not allowed to fluctuate. Okay, so this is known as a fixed exchange rate policy. So basically, the monetary authorities are going to manipulate the forex market to keep the nominal exchange rate constant. Well, why do they want to do this? Well, there are many reasons why. We'll talk about them in the later videos, but let's talk about how they can actually do this. Let's say the central bank expects E to increase. Okay, so we know that an increase in E is either a foreign appreciation or a domestic currency depreciation. So what the central bank is going to do to fix E is going to increase the supply of foreign currency in the forex market. You might be wondering, oh, why would they want to increase the supply of foreign currency? Let's take a look at the forex market again. So you got your demand and your supply. Initially, you've got E naught. So let's say they expect an increase in E because the demand curve shifted to the right. So if they do not do anything, E would increase to E1. So what they can do is to increase the supply of foreign currency so that E remains at E naught. So this is how the central bank is going to keep E constant at E naught. So what they're going to do is they're going to sell foreign currency reserves to the forex market, right? So when they do this, when they sell the foreign currency, what do they get back in return? Well, they're going to receive domestic currency in return from the market. So when they receive this domestic currency, they're going to keep it in their vaults. So there's lesser domestic currency circulating the economy right now. What that means is that the nominal money supply is going to fall. Okay, so this is the most important part. You have to remember this. You have to remember that the money supply will fall. Now, let's look at a case where the central bank expects that E is going to fall, which is a foreign currency depreciation or a domestic currency appreciation. So what the central bank does to avoid this is it's going to increase the demand for foreign currency. It's going to increase its demand. So let's take a look at the Forex market once again so that it'll be easier for you to understand. Okay, so that's my quantity and that's my price. So here's my demand curve and my supply curve. So initially, I'm at E naught. So E would fall if the supply curve were to shift to the right. So if the central bank doesn't do anything, the exchange rate is going to fall to E1. So to ensure that it is fixed at E naught, they are going to increase the demand for foreign currency. So how they can do this is they go to the Forex market and they're going to buy up more foreign currency from the Forex market. Okay, so when they buy this foreign currency, they're going to need to give in return domestic currency, right? So when they give domestic currency, there's going to be more domestic currency from their vaults that is circulating around the economy. Therefore, the nominal money supply in the domestic country is going to increase. And again, that is what you have to remember. It is very important. Okay, so just let me summarize this fixed exchange rate policy. You just gotta know that every time there is a fixed exchange rate policy, there's gonna be some kind of a change in the nominal money supply. And when that happens, you know that you're gonna have to shift your LM curve. So that's something that you gotta be expecting. And that brings me to the end on the basics of the open economy. I hope that you have learned quite a bit of stuff in this video. I wanna thank you for starting with Quickenomics. I'll see you in the next few videos where we go into detail about the open economy. Thank you.